Okay, I'm calling this meeting to order of Committee of the Whole on October 24th. Roll call, please.
Larson. Kuda.
Here.
Boyd. Oh, I think she's having some trouble with her audio. Maddox.
Here.
Hart.
Here.
Cobb.
Here.
Russell.
Okay, let the record reflect that four of us are here in person, and Anthony Maddox is on Zoom. And we see Janine Boyd's name there, but it says something's wrong with the audio. It's trying to connect. So they're both Zoom. Okay, so the first thing we have on the agenda is the discussion with the local CDCs. So if I could have a representative from Future Heights, one from StartRight, and HRC, if they have someone here, to come up to the table. I saw that we got three sets of questions back. Is that correct? Okay. 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 So, open to any questions here?
President Hart, I would like to hear what the session with the CDCs will entail this morning. So if you can conceptualize that for me, I'd appreciate it.
Say that louder, sir.
Okay. I would like to hear what the CDCs, why they're here this morning as a special session with the two or three of them if we see HRRC.
Wants to know if you could state the purpose of.
Well, the purpose is so that we gave them our questions.
Right.
And
no.
Now
no.
This is.
We never received questions.
There were no questions.
Okay. Holistic. So we're going to pose any questions that we have for them of their projects that they are requesting.
Okay. And I would suggest that Pastor Hicks answered a lot of our questions last week.
Yes, he did.
So.
Yes.
Just some point of clarification here. What we understood this meeting was about the different things that you, council, were going to fund with ARPA dollars that are on your list, and to find out what we as a CDCs can do with some of the things that your funding that we didn't request, such as the, Noble Road redevelopment plan, different things like that, that the StartRight or Future Heights or HRRC can do, like the gap financing could go in HRRC or something like that. I can't speak for them, but that's was my understanding of what us coming together as a group was, so.
It's to find crossover areas.
Yes.
Where you have, you're doing one thing and someone else is doing something similar, to see where you cross over and where there could be a collaboration, or maybe we give funding to one rather than the other for certain things. So it's trying to hone down to where we can make our allocation on the 31st.
Right. So I do want to clarify one thing, and although HRRC does great work and what they do contributes to how we can function and how we can do a better job, I just want to be clear they're not a CDC. So CDC is a specific thing, and I just wanted to make that clear going forward. Here's a little bit of how Future Heights has been thinking about this, and we have talked to StartRight as well. There is some frustration in trying to figure out how to carve the best path to support our city. We all want to do that. We all want to be utilized so we are supporting the city in accomplishing or making to fruition their vision. We all want to improve the quality of life for our residents. And we want to feel like we're making a difference in that support. There are many things that are not communicated to us that the city may or may not do. For example, how extensive is the landlord-tenant education? Who is part of the lead abatement team? Do they need an agent for that where a CDC or other nonprofit could handle that? What about fair housing? So there's all those little kind of things that can go on or that may be needed that we're just not understanding who's in charge of what. The second thing that we've really thought about is that I think that with exception to HRRC, because we haven't talked about it directly, but just knowing from the past, you have an organization here who's done down payment assistance, who's done some rehab work and does the repair work. Future Heights really wants to focus on the rehabilitation work and revitalization work. StartRight has carved out a place in the city they want to target with rehabilitation, but also with new construction. I think that with all of us, either we need to form, we could form something formally to truly strategize and put those into writing and so that we have those. But I think that we have the ability to take a look at our city and see what we can do, where the gaps are, where we are now, and where we need to go. And that's essentially what's missing, the communication. Well, what does the city do? What can we lift from the city? How can we work together to help the city? And somehow I think that's being lost in transition where it's becoming an us versus them sort of situation. Is our CIC going to do this? Is this organization going to do that? Let's then formally a group that can come together and strategize. The Future Heights has housing experts. You have a nonprofit that's expert in what they do. You have StartRight, who's an expert in what they do. We can bring that knowledge and we can bring those ideas to match whatever the administration, whatever council feels needs to happen within our city. What do you want the outcome to be? And we can work to fulfill that outcome.
Have you had any meetings with the administration on this?
We've had some here and there, nothing very, I would say, stringent or very detailed or very, I've met with Director Williams. We talked about this, actually, we had like a 2-hour conversation. But to me, it's, the essential question is, what do you want to do? What do you want Cleveland Heights to look like? What do you want the outcome to be? Because we're all kind of trying, scattering and figuring out, okay, I can do my part here. I can do my part here. But working towards one vision, one mission, and how we carve that up so that we can accomplish those goals, I think is so important. And this is where that ARPA money comes into play. Because not only, this is a 3-year program, so we have time to get started in what we know now, figure out where we want to go, put those things and those strategies into play, so that when the 3 years is up, we are poised to keep going. And that's with all the players together, with all of us, with the city, with other nonprofit partners, with SIDS that still exist, or you know, however that's going to play out. I think it's essential. If not, we're all going to keep doing our own thing and not really thinking about how we contribute to the whole.
Well, I agree. You do need to, it does need to be coordinated, because I can see, like, you want to put in a business group, and we have a business group in the city, so.
Well, a merchant association is much different than a SID.
Right, but they need to coordinate.
Right, and you can still have a SID and still have a merchant association. There's, we don't want to duplicate. No one wants to beat their head against the wall or waste money or feel like they're not making progress. But a merchant association is much different than a SID. So let the SID concentrate on what they need to do, and let a merchant association support in the other ways that it can support local businesses. So and that can be collaborated with each other.
It needs to coordinate with, the administration has a business development group. So it needs to coordinate with them as well.
And we're more than happy to talk with them. But a merchant association is something different than what a city can provide. We don't have a chamber here. And that's what we're offering, is that all businesses and all, doesn't matter what business district you're in, that we are learning from each other, and we're becoming a solid Cleveland Heights local business economy with the SIDS in the city and with everybody doing that fine-tuned work. It's not duplicated. It's supportive and collaborative, and hopefully offering something that somebody can't do.
Well, thank you for the comment on it. We'll take that under advisement within Committee of the Whole in terms of whether a meeting and how it would be structured. But in terms of, as we go, we do have to make decisions about ARPA. And we have to do it fairly quickly because we want to make sure they can be expended in time.
Right.
So, so, do you want to make any comments in terms of your proposals?
I have a question. I don't, you guys chime in when, you know, don't let me suck all the air out here.
Well, just real quick. Yeah. Like I said, in terms of, you know, our proposals, we have a 15-minute slot after this meeting. So I definitely don't want to waste this meeting on our proposals. When again, I'm looking at those items that you have and you're considering at the council, Madam Chair, in terms of they don't have a place where they're going, but there's something that you want to see happen as the council, and they weren't requested, they were put on by council people. They had to be put on by council people, and again, for StartRight. Those items dealing with Noble Road, especially, you know, the Caledonia area, the Noble Business District, those are the items that we are interested in helping council to, you know, to facilitate those items for you. So that would be where StartRight would see ourselves helping city council to get those items that you want done in that area with those dollars. So that would be I'll turn it over to the other.
Okay, so we had allocated $2.3 million to Noble, right? And what, can you read off the categories of the 2.3?
Specifically, so far, you guys had looked at lead safety programming of $400,000, down payment assistance or gap financing program of $300,000, an exterior repair program of $1 million, and community investment programs, which are to be determined in terms of what the actual programs would be for $600,000.
Okay, and that was the total for those?
Correct. So it would be 2.3 million for Noble, 2.3 million for Taylor, and 1.15 million for all other districts.
Okay. So Future Heights, as I mentioned at the top of the of our discussion, one of those items on that list that we'd be interested in is lead safety and lead safety education. But my other my question that I had is, as we consider our proposals, and maybe we need to adjust them, it sounds like, I'm under the understanding that no funds are going to be used for salaries. I just want to confirm that.
No, that's not necessarily true.
Okay.
What we're concerned about is if we're funding salaries on a permanent program and the ARPA funds are gone, well, then what?
Well, I think what we look at it is what we've been through in the last 3 years, too. Some of our funding is down because of COVID and because of the situation. It's also, we were in agreement where a salary was covered and then pretty much that was dropped. And so now we've had to make adjustments for that. So I think as we grow and people see what we do, and especially when you see the outcomes, you know, he's going to, StartRight's going to have an open house. They see the work that HRRC does. They see the work that we're accomplishing. That opens this up because we'll have good data to more grants, to more funding, to more, to really more of everything. You know, we all belong to organizations like the Ohio CDC or Main Street America, which we belong to, where we can get funding. But I think at the beginning, as we prepare these programs and have to do hiring, that it's helpful for those salaries to be paid so people can, so we can get to work as quickly as we can. But we have 3 years then to plan for how we keep going. So as I said at the beginning, so that we are poised to be able to continue long after the ARPA funds are gone. It's also money that can be reutilized. So as we have all discussed, you know, when we sell a house, that money goes directly back into our programs to continue it on. You know, those are allocated, whether someone else restricts those funds or we restrict those funds ourselves. So that money can allow us to keep going and keep supporting what we do.
And that's something that we really focus on at Home Repair Resource Center, because we understand how the city has to be nimble with their funds. And so we want all our project dollars to go to the homeowners. So we, you know, with all of our agreements, whether they be with the city of Cleveland Heights or other entities, it's, you know, we take our admin off the top, but we also do our programs in which there's contribution from the homeowner. So we're in this repair space. So just like Kristen was talking about, you know, how we do our developments with the Home in the Heights. But in our repair programs, we're doing 90-10 with everything. Skin in the game, right? And then it helps supplement that other revenue that to be able to make the program sustainable. So now when I go to said foundation or said committee, I could say, okay, this is what I'm willing to do to leverage. Because I realize, you know, when I sat in this seat 5 years ago, we couldn't really depend on what kind of funding we were going to get solely from the city of Cleveland Heights. We've been partners, obviously, great. It's just that we've had to be creative in being able to do so. So with that being said, you know, we keep monies in the coffers to be able to support, you know, what she's talking about with the hopes that we can get more money out in the streets to the homeowners, right? So, so just to kind of intersect too, in regards to our programs, we like to stay in our wheelhouse. I've spoke with Councilperson Crabb, and repair is the name of our game. And we want to kind of open kind of the playing field in which we're able to do more with our program dollars than we are able to because of the way the federal funding has been presented. So that's kind of how we're eyeing everything we're seeing and proposing to the city, as well as, you know, supporting the Building and Housing Department and all of their initiatives, and making sure that, you know, even if they have situations where they're not staffed or don't have the vision in how to kind of create these programs so they actually don't just target, you know, a certain group of people like they usually do, so we can, you know, do work in Noble. We can also do work, you know, on Washington. We can do work on the other side of the city, because that's what I think is missing in what the work that we're doing. So that's what our proposal is
so
focused on.
HRRC becomes a great partner for us who are doing rehabilitation work, our new construction. So as we are working on our two houses now, we've looked around the neighborhood and identified distressed homes or other vacant homes. That leads the way to new construction, because once you get those property values up and somewhere where someone can build that house for $300,000, be assessed valued at that, and be able to get a mortgage to build that house is so important. So as we look, we have the ability then to call up Keisha and say, hey, we've talked to these three neighbors who are around this house that we feel like as we rehab, we need to also lift these houses. Let's see if we can do something from them. If we also have extra monies, we are a part of revitalization. So revitalization could also be the landscaping, could be the pocket park, could be anything in that neighborhood that will truly lift it up and make a big impact, as opposed to a one-off, which we've all talked about, we don't think is the right strategy.
Madam President?
Yes.
And then,
Mrs. Larson?
That is what my vision is for the three people sitting in front of me representing these three organizations. That you work together, you may target an area, or you may just say, well, we're going to do this here while you're doing this over here. And that's that communication factor. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you're already establishing those connections. So I'm very happy to hear that happening.
Do you all meet?
Not formally.
Not yet.
Yep.
No, we telephone, but I'm just saying.
You get kind of busy, so you email here, email there.
Yeah, since we've been here, this is the first time, and again, we can meet, but it's more important that the city recognizes us. The city knows what we're doing. The city uses us in terms of, vacant home rehabilitation program, in terms of, disseminating the houses out. Over the past... we get a house on Caledonia. Future Heights has a house on Caledonia. They had a house on sale, and we had a house on sale, and just made no sense. I mean, for economies of scale, we could have done both of the houses on Caledonia together with, so that type of thing was being done, and we were just receiving what we were receiving, but there was no coordination among us to say, okay, well, you take those, we take these, So we needed that from the city, because the city is where we were, where we were receiving the supply of houses. Mine was coming from the city via the land bank for StartRight. Same thing with some of them, but some were coming straight from the city. So I don't know about that process, but I'm just saying this needs to be done. I mean, we can meet, but we can't make any decisions. We can't, do anything official. But we can meet and talk together. But unless the city is recognizing us and coordinating with us, then nothing really can happen based upon our conversations.
Well, it could happen, but then we're in competition with our city. We don't want to be in competition with our city.
We shouldn't be.
And we shouldn't be in competition. So, how the supply of houses are coordinated or some of the policies, again, like I said, when the city has a vision of what they eventually want this outcome to look like, what they want out of putting all this effort into housing and new construction, we can support that vision. We can get aligned. But right now, we don't have that North Star, so to speak, to follow. And so, yes, we can talk and coordinate and formalize anything that you would need to see from us. But, the pastor is correct. I mean, we have to know what, we have to know that our work is supporting what you want.
Madam President.
Now, I will try to put together a meeting so that we can coordinate this, because I think that is important. I agree.
Madam President.
Oh, yes.
I have my hand up.
Sorry. Councilman Kuda's first.
So we're obviously in a moment in time here, and I hear what you're saying, Christine. You know, we have these ARPA funds. We have some preliminary allocations that we've made, but we don't have a strategic plan. We don't have a housing task force. We don't know what the vision is, as you say, and the strategy to go with that vision that would implement this, whereby we have a CIC, but we don't, and we have CIC legislation, but we don't know, it hasn't been passed yet. We don't know the actual direction and how the coordination would work. So there's a lot of unknowns. Yet we're going to be making some decisions, you know, relatively soon. We've talked about, so far, exterior repairs, infill housing, money for infill housing, property acquisition, down payment assistance, a community investment plan. Is that what it's called? I'm sorry.
Fund.
A community investment fund, more for commercial areas and so forth. Landlord-tenant counseling or assistance has been brought up. So one of the reasons we asked you to come was, you know, to kind of narrow down what the capacity is of each organization. I'm going to assume one thing, and please tell me if I'm wrong, that when it comes to an exterior repair program, where we're, you know, we've discussed this with all three of you, I'm assuming that that's something all three entities are interested in participating in.
No.
Is that? Okay.
That's what I do. So, you know, as far as new development, that's what they do. As far as rehabilitation, that's what they do. So we've kind of in her speaking about what we do.
What I said was, as far as exterior repair program goes, what I said was, I'm assuming all three of you can do exterior repair programs. And you're saying no.
I mean, we can, but...
When you say do exterior repair programs, you mean programs where people come to us to get money to do exterior repairs?
Yeah, like administrate it, have. Okay.
No, that would not be StartRight.
We're really looking at HRRC would be our big partner in that.
Yes, that's what we
now,
do.
We certainly have, both of us, all of us, have the ability
knowledge,
to look
yeah.
at, and the knowledge, right, yeah. to look at a house and know what needs to be done and to counsel those people inside and connect them with resources.
Right. Yeah, we would not want to administer, you know, administrate a program for exterior repair.
That's what my proposal
direct them to.
Got it. Okay.
We don't want to duplicate. We all want to be working together in symphony yeah. with each other right. to accomplish the bigger vision. If one day Keisha comes to me and says, I've got so much exterior repair, I just can't handle it, you know, sure, maybe we'll help her out, you know, in that way. But really, for us to stay in our lanes and working with each other and giving each other resources and helping each other keep informed, you're going to have a better outcome. And then, you know, there's not this duplication or I've said the word before, I guess I'll say it again, but you don't want to set up a competitive atmosphere where we're all chasing the same dollars and the same people to service. We want to complement each other.
Yeah. So my suggestion, and I think this is what you've been alluding to, is that we have some kind of task force, especially when it comes to the allocation of ARPA dollars, but even beyond that, where the administration, our nonprofit / CDC partners, and the CIC and the council, to the degree that we're involved in this, come together to put something in place.
So what all three of us do really well because on the administrative side of this is putting together a proposal with summaries, objectives, outcomes, how we're going to do this, et cetera, because we write grants. Because we have to demonstrate that to other people who give us our funding. One of the things we could talk about, or one of the things that may help with deciding how these funds, or if these funds should be allocated, is that You do have a housing committee already, and we should be using that better with us. But we could also put together those strategies. You know, it wouldn't be an ongoing committee. It would be us coming together, figuring that out, and working in tandem with the housing committee, the administration, and who all the partners end up being. We can do that. That we would have to do that eventually, because if we're going to go forward with how we envision this, we're all going to have to look at the city strategically, right? And sometimes we forget about North Coventry. North Coventry has got a lot of issues that need to be solved. So I wouldn't say a continuous task force. I'd say someone who knows how to write the strategies, but let's work within some of the structures we already have and really utilize them and expand them if necessary, but not to create like yet another task force that might end up having another vision or having yet another, yeah. You know.
Well, that, that was what I was basically saying, almost like a select committee where you have a mission and it's not an ongoing thing, but it's to accomplish a goal. Right now, we need to figure out how to coordinate all these things that I just read off.
Right.
How is that going to be coordinated in this 3-year, you know, this limited time period?
Well, we are going to have to sit down together, because there's a lot of things to take into consideration, and those are the questions we'll be asking. For example, let's say we're doing a rehab and we've identified 6 houses, and I go to Keisha and I say, I have 6 houses that need repair work. She might say, okay, let's figure out how we're going to handle them. We're at capacity. Or we can handle this many, or we can handle that many. So there has to be a coordinated effort. We're not, what he's doing in the Caledonia area, we're not going to repeat there. We're going to go somewhere else in the city, right, that needs that work done. So we are going to have to ask those questions. We are going to have to talk to each other. We are going to have to put it down. So we are getting the most for a buck, pretty much. We have these funds. Where can we make the largest impact first? And then how do we set ourselves up to be successful after those funds are gone?
So a question for you, too, is...
Madam President, I believe...
Madam President.
Oh, sorry. Anthony.
So we need to have a conversation before we move any further, because there are several times we've tried to get attention and ask questions, and we have not been able to. And I feel like we are sitting on the margins of a conversation that the rest of the council needs to hear. I have now asked twice to speak and have not asked a single question. And so if this is going to be worth our time, and if we're going to honor the time of the people in this room, we need to figure out a flow for this process, because there are several things that I have tried to have a conversation about, both from a planning and development chair standpoint, as well as from the CIC. I've gotten none of those comments out. So whatever we need to do to repair this process, we need to do so immediately, because we're not being heard.
Okay, Councilman Maddox, sorry, I don't see you when you're just a thing on the screen. It's not easy to hear you.
Which
right
is why
away.
I was
so
muting
I apologize
myself,
again.
Again,
I apologize, and I'll make sure that. And Addie, if you see, can you alert me if I don't see him? Okay. Now, did you have other comments?
I haven't made any. So.
Well,
so.
I'm asking you if you have comments.
Yes, I have several. Number one, this is part of the conversation we need to continue to have about the work that the CIC is doing. Any communication or coordination can happen absolutely through the CIC. Number two, I want to make sure that as we're talking about the CIC, that we're not putting it in a silo. The CIC is not something that's far removed from council. There is council oversight on the CIC. So when we talk about decisions that they're making, we're also talking about members of the council, including the council president and chairman of planning and development that sit on that. That is part of that oversight. So when we're talking about council having a say, I don't want us to separate the CIC out from that when there are two members of council that sit on the CIC to make sure that we can have these conversations. And so I just want to make that clear that the CIC isn't some separate entity that council does not control. There are two members, including the president of council, on that. And so as we're having this dialogue, I want to make sure that we consider that. separately, as we're talking about many of our housing situations in this city, we're going to be looking at both housing and planning and development, because we're talking about both new construction and existing renovations on these properties. And so siloing it out in just one committee wouldn't be helpful at all. So I think our best bet is to really have a conversation about what the CIC looks like, what we want to do, and then partner based on that vision from that point, along with council, as we're talking about this legislation. So I just wanted to lay that out clear, but I know we've continued to have conversations about the CIC as if it's completely separate, when there is council oversight. It was created that way through council legislation. And so I just wanted to clarify that the CIC being a part of this makes sure that council is also a part of this decision-making and any strategies that we create.
Okay, thank you, Councilman Maddox. I did want to reset us here, because we're actually here to talk about ARPA. And although these are important things about, you know, having coordination, and we will talk about how to best do that, today we're here to talk about ARPA. And I don't want us, since we only have 20 minutes left for the CDCs, then I think we need to move forward with the ARPA. Also, I want to be clear that the CIC should not be a competition. It should be part of the process, not a competition with what is already out there. So let's move on to discuss ARPA. And you had asked also, Reverend Hicks, about other things. Yes, we were, one of the things we had discussed within Committee of the Whole was whether, I mean, for Noble having a development plan rather than just piecemealing things in. But as I said before, it cannot be a plan that goes on a shelf. It has to have the city commitment to implement. So it would have to be coordinated with the city. So certainly, we're not certainly not opposed to partnering with anyone. We have to coordinate with the city as well. So, although we would be looking at more than just to Woodview, we'd be looking past Woodview as well.
Is there a question you need us
to? I was just talking about his comment, yes.
Right. No, I know that even the dollars that were set aside by council, for Noble Road, and I'm not, I don't have full information about those dollars, but we know that just concentrating on Nila View to Woodview would not encompass the entire amount, but it is a section that would be that we would be focusing on for some of the dollars, and with the time constraint of 2026, it gets something started, and hopefully something done, a plan that will then go into development for that area. Depending upon how fast it can happen, or if other developers see what we're doing, someone might want to go and look at Roanoke all the way up to Mayfield, mm-hmm. or Roanoke to Delmore, or and then someone doing the triangle, it might set what we're doing might set a precedent for others to look at smaller sections, instead of going, wow, Noble Road Development Plan was all the way from Euclid to Mayfield. Who can tackle that? And it just sits on the shelf. And so that's, we're looking at, this piece of it, old adage is, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And this is a bite that we're willing to look at to take care of, and then again hopefully set a precedent for the rest of Noble.
Okay.
Madam President, I think we need to have a discussion on some of this information that's being sent out today as well, because some of this I don't think was some of this in the outline of what was envisioned, and some of it needs to be tweaked and further discussed.
Are you referring to Start Right?
I'm referring to the $2 million that's allocated to the Noble area.
Oh, yeah, the $2.3 million, which is lead abatement, programs, exterior. And what was the last one?
It was $400,000 for lead safety programming, $300,000 for down payment assistance and gap finance programming, $1 million to exterior repair program, and $600,000 to community investment programs. Now, that's just a starting point.
Okay.
Correct, but I'm talking about the $2 million that's designated. So we were, you remember, I've been talking a long time ago, all the long. We don't want it. The intention was not for it to be piecemeal meal together. So I just want to say we just need to have a further discussion on the intent of that.
Well, we can take that up at the next meeting when we start the allocations.
I was under the impression, Councilwoman Russell, when I watched the meeting last week in regards to planning and development, that the allocations that Eddie just talked about were specifically to the Noble area, which was yes. kind of that breakdown, and then there's other ones, and I just want to make sure that's clear in what I'm thinking about with my proposal, because those amounts factor into what I'm asking to do in that specific area.
Yes, so that's correct.
I just want to clarify that.
And there's a similar, the same amount for Taylor as well.
Right, which was another separate portion.
Right.
That's separate from that. And Councilwoman Russell, is that?
Well, that's why I said we needed to have a further discussion about it.
Okay.
Because the $2 million was the bottom line. It was not the max. And everyone said we could go to the max, but we were looking for to have a true plan for the whole area of Noble, not piecemeal it and put $2 million here, $2 million here, because if you have $2 million, it's not going to go very far. But you need to be able to take that $2 million and make a very large impact where all residents can see where the $2 million went. And that's what I want to have a discussion about.
Okay. And the amounts that we quoted here were already decided by council at a previous meeting, and it adds up to $2.3 million for Noble, $2.3 million for Taylor. It is not the max. I mean, we can go beyond that, and we talked about a plan for Noble. So those items have not been decided yet, the additional amounts. 2.3 is already decided.
Right, okay. That's what I thought. I'm sorry.
I still say we still need to have a discussion.
Well, we will be having a discussion
because
there's more funds.
No, we're not having it today. We're not having it today.
I
need some clarification.
Okay. Okay. Other questions, comments, requests of the CDCs?
I'd just like to make one last comment just because to me it is something that's very important that there is an understanding of the CIC because that is going to directly affect how ARPA is allocated. Don't get me wrong. I've worked under a CIC before. CICs are a great tool for a city to have because you need to be able to make the purchases and sales that you need to make. CICs, if you look at all of us, the pastor will tell you specifically what this CDC is about. I will tell you what we're about. Keisha will tell you we're about home repair. So it would be helpful to know at some point what the CIC wants to concentrate on. Is that going to be mostly commercial? Is that going to be most whatever it's going to be? So that we can all fit together. I just think it's important because it is a separate entity. You are creating a nonprofit from your city that the rules, that the laws that accompany that CIC and that structure be upheld. And when there's changes or rule changes that need to or to be presented, why those changes are being asked to be made. I think that's really important because it does affect, you know, we have to do everything within the parameter and the laws and the ordinances and things. We just can't go out and build a new house without going through ABR. We can't just be, you know, making repairs without building permits and stuff like that. So that's really important that we have that understanding and so that we can work together to make a big impact on the city. So, but I think that with the ARPA funds, you know, we've been pretty clear on what we can do, and we're looking over at a three period of, a period of 3 years. But there is oversight and things we could do. And one of the things that if you want to, and if Keisha and the pastor are, if you have a list of things like lead abatement, like landlord, all those things we talked about, is who has capacity for it and who can do it truly. Because it doesn't make sense when you have a CDC or a nonprofit who can do that work where it won't cost the city additional resources to let that entity do that.
Yes.
Madam Chair, I wanted to ask a question, if I may.
Sure.
Councilman Kuda, if you could, probably help us understand the rehabilitation dollars that you requested to be set aside and how, that we would be able to access those dollars, how you envision it, if you guys allocate that for the rehabilitation of housing.
Yeah, so right now, we've discussed in some detail that we would set aside $2.5 million for people who've been adversely economically impacted by COVID, homeowners, for exterior repairs. And we haven't made a final decision on whether it would be a 50-50 or, maybe some kind of sliding scale. I mean, we have discussed the possibility of expanding it past a matching fund type of a thing. But these would be people who have code violations and exterior repairs that would apply. The homeowner would apply for the money. And if they live in a qualified census tract, if they're, 120% AMI, I could be wrong about that exact. Is that the right amount? Okay. Or age eligible. So, and then we would advertise, people would apply, and then it would be administrated possibly by HR.
Right.
So is there a housing acquisition? And that might be more what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Housing acquisition, property acquisition.
Property acquisition.
Weren't there some dollars you were setting aside for property?
Yes. Acquisition?
Okay, that's the part. I'm sorry. I'm misquoted.
And I'm not saying that on the front page, but I believe it was $1 million for property acquisition. Addie, do you?
Yeah, if you look in the notes section of CIC Startup Funds, it says that they had requested an additional million. However, you guys had said you weren't necessarily comfortable with that. You had, in your original proposal, Councilman Kuda had asked for, I believe it was $750,000 for property acquisition for vacant and abandoned properties, for rehab, for sale to potentially owner-occupieds.
Yeah, and I believe we upped it in a...
Well, and I was going to say, on your proposal, it didn't necessarily say who would be administering this.
Right.
My assumption,
correct,
I think you were thinking would be the CDCs, and I believe Future Heights has asked for potential property acquisition of $300,000. Start rate, was it 500 from you guys? What was 200 from you guys? So that would be a total of 500,000 right there. So you'd have a little bit left over to work with too, if you decided to go with their proposals.
Right. And the objective there was to compete with LLCs on distressed property acquisition, so that, everything that ever hits the market doesn't automatically go to the cash buyer, the online cash buyer from out of town.
Right, we can restrict those deeds, right.
No, and so I guess my thought process too is that were we overlapping with your program, or your program would be over and above what we were asking for?
The $1 million on the CIC was
no, not the CIC. I'm not speaking about CIC.
You mean the other?
I was speaking about the what Councilman Kuda, Madam Chair, he had
he had proposed dollars that he was not proposing for the CIC. He was proposing, and correct me if I'm wrong, just proposing that you wanted those dollars there. And I guess I was looking at how did you envision the CDC's being able to have access to those dollars?
Yeah, so we did not talk, you're right, Madam President, we did not talk about the administration of this, I don't believe. But this happens a lot in our ARPA process so far. I mean, it's happened with, you know, public art, you know, where we've said, okay, we'll set aside this much money, but then three or four nonprofits say they want to do public art, you know, so we're working. So I see this all working within the $1 million, not, you know, allocating in addition to separate proposals.
Might you consider talking with us, the other nonprofits or whatever, because we could tell you our experience and what might be a good process to ask for those dollars. You know, if you keep it in a lump fund and how you administer it, how we might ask for those funds to be allocated. One of the things in this process that I think that would have helped a lot is at the beginning, if we had an application process with some criteria. And so now we can do that on a micro level, right? So if you get $1 million and you talk to the people who may be considering those funds, what you would need from us, what kind of application process or kind of process that we can get to show how we would use that money. I mean, we have 3 years, you know, nothing, not everything has to come at us all at once, you know?
Now we're down yeah, to two. And I think, I mean,
well, not, now we're down to two,
not to be
whatever.
In opposition of what folks were saying, but I, from the conversations and the meetings I'm hearing, it seems like the CIC is moving in that direction where they will be doing RFQs, RFPs, mm-hmm. And the way the mayor speaks and the chair of that committee in that last meeting, Councilperson Maddox. So I'm encouraged by that because, you know, as they have proposals, you know, I've been, you know, talking with council members as well as the administration kind of waiting for this moment and with the assumption that there would be some kind of RFQ, RFP that will be issued by the city. So then we can, you know, problem statements and kind of do what we do best. So I'm encouraged that it seems as though the CIC is moving in that direction and the funding is going to be there in hiring an executive director and kind of getting that shaped up. So then I think it'll be a lot more formalized working between nonprofits, administration, and council. So that's my...
Okay, so...
Madam President, just to close the loop in Reverend Hicks' question. So the idea was that after, you know, property would be purchased, it would be, you know, there'd be a rehab budget. And then once that property was flipped to an owner-occupied buyer, it would be self-sustaining in, you know, well beyond 2026 and so forth.
Okay, so we're getting to the end of this period and we have other not-for-profits. But the next steps, so that you're clear, is we go back after we make allocations of where we want to put funds and we say, okay, to Guidehouse, that can they give us some sample programs, because they've gone through this with many different cities and they know what's required by the government. So they'll help us to set up the programs that are needed. Where we need additional, you know, where we're giving it to a not-for-profit, then of course that's a little different pattern for that because you'd be setting up your own programs. Where there are things where we have decided to give money and we don't as a city want to actually necessarily have ourselves do that, we'll reach out to have look at our not-for-profits for assistance on it, like, you know, development or whatever. So the next step is that we do the allocations and their dollar amounts, and then we go through the process with Guidehouse to develop the programs under them and allocate to the not-for-profits because they have their programs already determined. So we're hoping to get it done on October 31st. may stretch another meeting if it has to, but I want it done very as quickly as possible.
No trick-or-treating for you.
No trick-or-treating, yeah. Okay, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you for having us.
And we'll follow up on also having a meeting for coordination.
Okay.
Oh!
Okay. Oops. Okay, our first.
Madam President, we do have 2 minutes if you want to take like a short little.
Okay, why don't we take a brief break so everyone can have their, go get something to drink, we'll reconvene in.
2 minutes.
Well.
3 minutes.
5 minutes. Okay, I'm calling this meeting back to order. Now we'll begin to hear from the other not-for-profits, and our first one up, and for everyone, it's a 15-minute time slot for each not-for-profit. So the timer will be up there so you can see where we're at, but we have to do that in order to keep, like, not being here all day. So I think our first one is Lake Erie Inc.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'm Amy Rosenbluth. I'm the executive director of Lake Erie, Inc., a writing space for youth.
And what we want to do here is everyone has the answers to your questions. Mm-hmm. So we want people to be able to ask any follow-up questions they have for you and also for you to give any updates that you might want to give.
Sure.
So... any questions from the council? I did have one question. On the rent in the back, mm-hmm. where you have the budget.
Yeah.
And the $5,300 for 3 years, it says it accounts for 1/3 of the rent increase. So your rent increase was $15,900 per year?
We're looking at rent increase for each year. So that would be covering the rent increase for the next 3 years.
Right.
So over 3 years, it would be 15,000. Yes, the rent went up significantly for us this year, and it will be increased for each year following. So that was an estimate of the increase over the next 3 years.
So the 5,300 is the actual increase, or it's a third of the actual increase?
It would be a third of our actual rent.
So a third of your rent?
Yes.
Not of the increase? Okay.
Correct.
A third of the rent, and yes. Your increase was?
And that's an estimate because we don't know exactly yet, but there is a 3% increase that's written in.
3%?
Yes.
And this increase was how much of a percentage of increase?
I don't understand the question.
Oh.
We're going to get our next lease, so this is looking forward. We're planning ahead
okay.
for the next 3 years.
So are you going to, by us... but by this amount, $5,300,
mm-hmm.
with us paying $5,300,
we still would be paying an additional $7,500
okay.
or so of the rent. Yes,
okay.
It's just covering what the increase would be, what we think the increase would be. Yeah.
Okay.
Just to help us build our capacity and stay sustainable okay. for the next 3 years.
And then you would anticipate you would be able to pay your rent after that with
yes,
the
yes.
funding. Okay.
It would give us a little bit of a cushion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Councilor Larson.
Good morning.
Good morning.
On the professional development training,
mm-hmm.
have you already identified an agency or a group that can help with the social-emotional professional development?
Yes, we work, there are three or four different organizations that we have that we go to when we can, when we have the funds. Starting Point right here in Cleveland is one. Actually, we're presenting there this Friday at a conference. We're sending a couple of our staff. And then the National Guild for Community Arts Educators. We do attend the National Council of Teachers of English, and then we do a lot with Case Western. It's called the Community, the Youth Development Consortium, and they are really focused on helping youth workers understand trauma and best practices. So we definitely have, we don't know year to year what things will be offered, but we know where to go to find them.
You have the resources.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Councillor Maddox, do you have any questions?
No questions, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else with questions? Yes, Councillor Kuda.
This isn't about the funding, but what's the, so the covering the scholarships for 125 students, how do you do the outreach or the identification of that? And is that part of this proposal?
No, I mean, we connect with a lot of different places. So we put our information out in libraries and schools and churches. I mean, we do a huge sort of outreach in a general way. And then more specifically, we connect with school counselors. We're connected with PEP. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
Sure.
We do work with kids who might have more needs than traditional classroom students. We send things to PTAs. We put things up all over town. What happens is we don't require people to apply for scholarship. We say that they need to ask, and we talk with them a little bit because we found there's a stigma attached when there's a whole lot of paperwork before somebody has a conversation.
So if, when you...
So if we receive this funding, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh, sorry.
If we receive specific funding, because this would only go towards youth in Cleveland Heights, that would become part of the messaging. So are you a student in Cleveland Heights who's looking for creative enrichment? But, you know, that would be part of the messaging, so it would be more specific.
You anticipated my next question very well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yes. Question, and I'm sorry that this was already asked. So to the extent that with your rent, are you increasing the amount of space that you guys are renting or no?
No.
And then the scholarships, is this to expand the program or is this simply to
it's
affordable for those kids that don't have funds?
It's directly for the students to attend. So we're not necessarily adding more. We have a very robust program. We would like to make sure that all youth are able to participate and that money's, we don't charge very much anyway. But I think having that support, it allows us to do it without losing any quality, right? So we're being reimbursed for offering that scholarship, if that makes sense. Currently, we allow anybody to come. We don't turn kids away, but we don't have a way to then supplement our own efforts.
So then currently, what would you charge a student from an affluent family that could afford it?
It depends on the program, but like summer camp is $200 for a two-week program, right? So that's what summer camp is. Our evening programs range from $150 for 10 weeks to $180, I think, for our two-hour programs for 10 weeks. So with this money, we would be in charge of sort of divvying it up, you know, if people come in. One of the biggest programs that we offer is Kids Comic-Con. We see about 150 youth. To be able to say, and it's $20 for an all-day set of workshops and experiences to be able to say that 20 kids from Cleveland Heights can come and there's no, you know, that's a wonderful thing to be able to offer. So we would then, when the money is used for the year, what we would do is divide that money per year so that we know what we're working with and say, this is how much scholarship money we have for these programs. This is for summer, for this year, and when it, and then work from it that way.
How do you normally fund this?
Fund what? Well, we charge people. These are what we call our core programming. So kids come to us. We do have a charge, a fee for some of them. And then we write grants. And we're funded from the Ohio Arts Council and Cuyahoga Arts and Culture. So some of our funding is allowing us to provide those programs. And then we fill it in with fees from families.
Approximately how much of this ask would represent your total budget?
Oh, that's a good question. So our total budget for this current year is $495. So we're right at about, so I'm looking, again, going into, this would go into next, well, it would probably cross years a little bit. You're welcome. Are there
anything else? No.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Next, we have Start Bright Hunger Center.
How's it going, everybody?
But how are you?
Well, I am well. So I just, you know, we submitted some questions. Well, the questions we submitted the paperback to answer some of the questions. But I will say that, you know, as we know, ARPA funds fill a need, but they also allow us to dream of what we can do in the future. And so I think if you look at some of the budgets that were provided, it speaks to a few, you know, future vision of the food center and where we can go in the future as we look to help people that are experiencing food poverty.
Yes, Counselor.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to reiterate what Pastor Hicks Sr. said last week when we were talking about the Hunger Center, that you're looking at building an intake center so that people would, in my mind, have privacy, right, when they come in to apply for food and additional help.
Correct. And so that's I had that list. I don't have the intake center, but I have conversion of a new office space, which is what we would use as our intake center.
All right. Thank you.
So the capital expense for the parking lot that's mm-hmm. not just dedicated to the food pantry, is it?
So currently as it exists, there is no, we don't have a parking lot on property. And so using as a capital expense for a parking lot, the food pantry, Cleveland Food Bank, has a program called the Mobile Pantry where they are able to bring in an RV that's 90% full of fresh produce. And so one of the things that we know about the Caledonia neighborhood right now is that there is nowhere to get quality produce right now. That is a huge issue of Save-A-Lot, one of the biggest complaints that we've heard about Save-A-Lot right now. And so one of the requirements for them to bring in the mobile pantry is a parking lot, that you have to have a parking lot to be able to do that. And so to be able to get that constructed, we can work with the Cleveland Food Bank to schedule out that availability through their application process. But one of the main requirements that they have for that is a parking lot. So that's why you see that there. That also allows us, again, looking towards the future, farmers markets and things of that nature that we can begin to bring and infuse into the neighborhood, again, looking at access to fresh quality produce. And so that's kind of the justification behind the parking lot expense. Also, as we look to ramp up kind of our capacity in terms of bringing in more, you know, advertising and finding people that are in need of more, we want to be able to use without being an impact to the traffic flow that's on the street. Currently, as it stands right now, people have to line up to the, you know, on the street and wait in line as it goes. And so a parking lot would be able to help alleviate some of that traffic congestion that we are envisioning in the future.
Councilor Kuda.
Thank you. So I have two questions. One is, I'm going to say it in a statement, but it's a question. I'm going to assume that you serve more than just Cleveland Heights.
Correct.
Okay. And secondly, is there anything that you do, that Start Right does, not the food pantry in particular, to connect your customers with any kind of other assistance that would help them become independent?
Holistic care kind of approach. So that if you, you know, looking at, you know, there was the question about key milestones or deliverables in terms of success. And so I've included some milestones. And one of those is being able to connect to holistic wellness. And that's a big part of why we want to create that intake center so that we can have that conversation with people. Again, we're not necessarily qualified social care workers or things of that nature, but as we look to the future, we know that people who are suffering from food shortages or food inequality can have some other things going on. And so being able to have those conversations with individuals, if they're willing to, we can connect them with other qualified resources within the city, within the county, within the state. But that is a goal that as we look to grow and expand, we want to make sure that we're looking at the whole person and not necessarily just symptoms of one aspect that somebody's suffering from. But that is a goal that we have. And these dollars, again, that'll be a way that we measure some of the success that we see with the funds that we're requesting.
All right. Thank you.
On the conversion of new office space,
mm-hmm.
is that office space that would be only used for the hunger program or used for other things?
Correct. So as it stands, there is no dedicated office space for the Hunger Center. And so this would be a dedicated office space for Start Right CDC to use, again, as an intake center facility and to carry out the business of the Hunger Center and other duties of Start Right CDC. But yes, that is what we're looking to accomplish.
And with the Hunger Center, when you load it into their car, right? They drive up and you load it into their car?
Current, yeah. And in its current iteration, we load the bags in the cars right now.
Okay. And is that what you anticipate?
Our vision and how we started was a healthy choice self shopping pantry where we still have a row of shopping carts that people are able to come and walk through the facility and choose what works for their family. We would love to get back to that, but in the format that we are right now with the weekly pantry, we don't have the ability to do that. So do we want to stay in a mobile pantry putting bags in the cars? It works. It's a model that many food pantries use. But again, one of the things that we thought that made our pantry unique was that self-choice, healthy shopper kind of element that kind of gave people, a lot of people to maintain a sense of dignity. There's nothing wrong with asking for help for food, you know, food and things of that nature. But for somebody to be able to walk through and kind of emulate and simulate a grocery store experience, we saw a lot of success with that.
So how would this help that?
So as we look to grow, again, we don't want to eliminate because we're seeing a lot of success with people that want to text. They want to just, here's what I want, throw it in my car. And so this could work in tandem and in addition to the self-choice healthy shopper. Because again, as we look to grow and expand, we had one monthly food pantry that met on Saturdays that we did the shopping. What we do now is during the week. And so we believe and what we see in our numbers is that there are still other groups of people who aren't available on Thursdays that still need food. And so as we look to grow and expand, we would look to add and expand additional days for people to get food. And so that's kind of how it would work in tandem. And so as we look at increased traffic flow, increased capacity, again, looking at the parking lot, that would be able to be a huge help with that.
So this proposal, is this just for 1 year?
So this is in terms of capital improvements would be a 1 year project. You know, we would be able to try to tackle those in 1 year. When you look at down to the allocation of this budget, we would be able to spread that out over at least 3 years. Again, I was assuming, I don't have our numbers that we submitted to CDBG, the committee, or the CAC committee, and that kind of breaks down some of our other operating expenses. I didn't try to duplicate those expenses to make it seem like we're asking for, you know, the same thing twice over. But a lot of the food that we purchase is subsidized through the Cleveland Food Bank, and so in 1 year we would not spend $11,000 for staple food items because of a great deal of that is subsidized through the Cleveland Food Bank. But what it would allow us to do is to be more aggressive in the items that we can't get through the food bank or are scarce through the food bank. And so we could order items in bulk in mass quantities and be able to store those things up. One thing that we learned during COVID is to, you know, you can't predict the future. And so to be able to, you know, create emergency food kits with non-perishable items to have on the ready so that if anybody in an emergency, a fire, whatever the crisis may be, we could have food ready, already packed that, you know, has a extended shelf life if we ever were to face another pandemic or something of the sort. And so that's some of the future planning that we are putting in place due to COVID. How could we prepare for another pandemic if it were to happen? Things of that nature. And so it's spread out through 3 years. But again, as we are seeing prices go up, if the number of people that come through our doors increase exponentially, then those funds could get used up faster. But I'm envisioning a 3-year period with this ask right here in terms of the operating budget and produce.
And then if you could give me some details on the storage and refrigeration upgrades, if you could allocate between those two.
Sure. So storage and refrigeration upgrades. So currently right now we have one commercial freezer, one commercial refrigerator. The rest of the freezer space and refrigerator space we have are your more so household refrigerators and freezers. And so being able to upgrade, there's a commercial refrigerator. It's a 3-door you see it in schools a lot. That's $15,000. And so that will allow us to increase the amount of fresh produce that we would be able to store on site, because we're limited based on refrigeration space. Also, you know, dairy products, things of that nature. And then, of course, storage-wise, again, we have, you know, shelving racks and things of that nature that we have created a pantry. But again, if we're looking to create designated space for emergency food or things of that nature, being able to build out that storage space is what that would be allocated for. And so one refrigerator, the refrigerator I referred to, was about $13,000. So if we were to just get two refrigerators, that would give us 6 brand new commercial refrigerators that would, you know, greatly increase. Now, of course, there are other options out there, but that's just one that I use for a reference point.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Did you have any update you wanted to give us or no? Just said.
No, other than I'm need some sleep. I got a 6-month at home, so that's the only update I have.
Thank you.
Can't help you with that.
Okay, next we have Heights Libraries.
Good morning.
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 Hi, I'm Nancy Levin, the director of the library. This is Kayla Sweeney, our special projects manager. And we are here to answer your questions. Should I just go ahead and answer them in order that they were presented, or would you like to ask questions first? How do you want to proceed?
I was going to let them ask additional questions.
Okay.
President Hart?
Yes.
Yeah. I am very impressed with the involvement that you've had with ADA compliance experts. And I'm just trying to envision the equipment in place and a child comes up or an adult in a wheelchair. How are they made welcome?
Well, the main new element will be a circulating loop paths.
Okay.
That will be less than a 5% grade. One of the biggest expenses that's not listed on the sheet is the leveling of the whole site, especially on the corner of Coventry and Euclid Heights Boulevard. So mm-hmm. we have to scrape that down and make the whole site more accessible. And then each of the elements, the stage, the playground, have circulating paths that get you right to the equipment. And each of the pieces of equipment have been rated by their manufacturer and other safety organizations in Canada and the United States to be accessible. And when you're comparing it to the safety of what is there now, there is no comparison.
Right. Thank you.
Do have some funding updates from when we originally applied?
Which we okay.
To, but did you
are they in here or they you have additional?
I think they are here. Yes.
Okay. Okay. See that.
The price of the product or the project is the $300,000 we're asking for ARPA money is 12% of the project cost. But the maintenance is all on us. There's no extra cost to the city.
Okay. This is all strictly capital.
Yeah.
President Hart?
Yes.
Could you describe what the parking lot improvements are going to look like? Please.
There are quite a few right now in the phase one. There are just two sides of the curbs that are on both ends of the parking lot that need to be adapted to make room for the path with the benches and things on it. And they're also where we're doing pollinator gardening and some bio filtration to make sure the runoff is cleaner. And when we get to phase two and we actually redo the parking lot, there is an issue there with some caving in of the surface, and we believe that is where the culvert is for the Dugway Brook. We've patched it a couple of times, so I think we need to reinforce it with concrete and restripe, just stabilize the whole parking lot again. There is a tree plan that we have submitted to the city. There'll be trees all around, and the whole thing will be refurbished because it's just starting to really fall apart.
Thank you, Nancy.
Will you repeat? So if it's falling in because of the culvert, will there be repair of the culvert underneath?
I don't know. We'll find out when we get there. But there are some potholes that we've been filling that will probably need to be addressed later. We became the owner of the whole property and we accepted the responsibility for the whole property.
Yeah.
So we will make sure that it is in good shape. And it's taken us a little while to get there, but we're very excited that the playground will be a draw for the whole community and certainly for the Coventry neighborhood. It is absolutely library work to have programming outside. I just got a catalog that's full of nature books. And all of our partners, some of whom you're meeting with today, all use the park, and I think it's like a central element of the city.
Okay. Other questions?
The accessible interpretive signs, could you give us some details on that?
The ones we've seen are at chair height. So if I'm sitting in a wheelchair, the plane would be like this high. They have tactile features, and if it, let's just say it's metal, it would be raised and could have Braille. We haven't designed them yet, but we know that the content, we are planning on at least three signs. One that tells the history of the neighborhood and the original park. One is sort of natural history. You are on the bluestone shale escarpment leading to Lake Erie. This is, you should be aware of where you are in the world. And then another one probably talking more about the human history of the three historic neighborhoods that surround the park and why it's here.
Okay. And so, if you haven't designed them yet, how did you guys come up with an estimated cost of $50,000?
Our landscape architect knows what we're looking for, mm-hmm. and he offered us a number of choices. So we are choosing the least expensive but most functional kind of sign we can find.
And the parking lot improvements, do you guys have an estimate on that, or?
No, that's not in phase one, so we will have an estimate in January, but we will probably delay the parking lot improvements until we can accomplish the park improvements. And we are also trying to keep the Coventry Peace Building in good shape too. So the library is doing a lot of heavy lifting in Noble neighborhood and in Coventry neighborhood after we've already done UH and Lee Road.
And so to the extent that we provide you funding, I'm assuming that these items that are on here, you'll be able to do an accounting so we can satisfy our
absolutely
reporting requirements.
I can tell you what we spent on every book. I can tell you what we spent on every person. We are the bookkeeping capital of the world. And people do ask to look, and we show them.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else, anyone? Okay.
Do you want to plug the fundraiser before you go?
Sure. Thank you. Sunday, November 5th at the Grog Shop, we will be holding a fundraiser. We realize that it's right before the election, so maybe people want to stop by and shake hands. It's $25 to enter, and we will be selling merch from the park, t-shirts and other things to raise money for the park.
Do you want to give the time?
4 to 7.
Yes.
Thank you. And the band playing is Grandview, which is a bunch of local gentlemen from Grandview Street.
And the first round is on Mr. Kuda.
Okay. Are you in the band, Tony?
I don't see that in the proposal.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Next, we have building heights.
Madam President, just as a reminder, if everyone can speak into the microphone, I'm just getting a text that it's a little hard to hear.
Okay, okay. Hi.
Hello.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And I don't know if you're here when I gave... Everyone, we have 15 minutes for each not-for-profit, and we're going to have people ask any additional questions they have, and you can provide any updates as well.
Okay.
Questions?
Well, I'll just say... If I could, as always, my concern is, and I think I mentioned this earlier, when a significant part of the ask is for salaries. So if you could go into some detail on that, how these amounts were arrived at, that would be appreciated.
So for salaries, I think we, you know, we went over, well, first off, we've since changed from being just a program, but an actual organization, which is Building Heights. So now we are a nonprofit and have our 501c3 status. So, and that was our goal. And so asking for ARPA funds was to, with this amount, was to provide a salary for an executive director eventually, and to cover costs for things related to the programming that we have acquired. So we, based off of the questions that were sent to us and just kind of going through it with our now board that we currently have, we decided to consolidate some of the salaries because we want to focus the ARPA funds where it's needed. So we decided to just have our executive director as a salaried individual for the next 3 years, and through grant writing and et cetera, we'll hope to maintain that. It's not to say that's the salary we're going to have, but at least we'll have a nice range. And then with principal instructor, we've always had that. Everything that's listed currently is what we've always had. Principal instructor, film instructor, who can also edit, and then adding on those two additional programs that we want to see happen for our students from fifth grade to 10th grade. We've added in those two instructors, which is sort of like a stipend that we would give to those individuals for quality work that they would provide. So, and then everything else is equipment. Equipment is very expensive. We have a board member that is currently a director and a producer, and we talked about that. And then supplies, production, and then wanting to have our kids go on location where we take them to a film set, whether it's local, not here in the state of Ohio. We want to give our kids experiences so they have an understanding of what opportunities are out there. And that's pretty much it. And then operating costs, there's a possibility that we have to pay rent because originally as a program, we were always in the high school. But now that we know that Tiger Camp is not going to continue because ESSER funds are no longer available to provide services for Tiger Camp, there's a possibility that we may have to pay rent, or we have to pay rent somewhere else to hold the program. I know, I'm very sad too, but we don't know, we don't know. Equipment, storage, same thing. If we were to purchase equipment, we'd have to have storage for that equipment. And then marketing, publicity, hiring someone possibly, or us doing it, or having to get ads for marketing or just printing, insurance, and then of course having annual events that we normally have in September, sort of on a shoestring budget, but hopefully we can continue to have events where we have an annual benefit or some sort in order to help continue to fund through private donations or sponsors. So that's pretty much what we revised.
Yeah, thank you. I was trying to find your earlier proposal, and I do see now that you did.
Well, because we transitioned from being just a program for the camp, we know our goal, which is what we stated on record, that we want to become a nonprofit, and we became a nonprofit over the summer. So that kind of that shifts not the mission, not the goal, but it shifts the way that we're running, which is, I think, pretty conservative, and hopefully we can sustain that going forward. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Counselor?
Thank you. Currently, I've been to a few of these things. Mm-hmm. Currently, I'm assuming the kids film with their phones.
Actually,
is that true?
Don't. We only could hire individuals because we don't have our own equipment. Mm-hmm. We have to hire individuals that actually have their own equipment. So our film instructors that we've had in the past always brought their equipment.
I see. Yeah, okay.
So, but sometimes, like when we became years ago, when we had to do something virtual, the pandemic happened, when we were in a theater camp, they used their own equipment. And they're still able to do that, but to have the type of quality work that we want to show, to have more people invest in our program, we want to have quality.
So the $15,000 is for that equipment?
Just specifically for that equipment.
Is it just for the video equipment, or does it include audio? I'm not trying to be overly critical, but that was the weakness.
Both audio and video, like an audio recording system. I mean, the thing about having the instructors bring their own equipment is that they didn't plan on having this equipment handled by two dozen
middle school kids, right?
So we really need to have our own.
And of course, insurance too.
Two cameras and recording.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like a boom microphone.
Right. That was definitely a missing piece. Although, I have to say they did wonders with what they had.
Yeah.
And I didn't even know that this was like, borrowed equipment, I guess, technically.
Yeah.
But
yeah, it was included into their contracts when they so graciously took on our budget.
The thing I like about this proposal is that it has a lot of opportunities for kids who are not going to be acting or filming per se, like directing or operating camera, but there's these other aspects that could bring in kids that was my initial concern, was that it was, for lack of a better term, a narrow interest that kids may or may not have. And this kind of expands that, you've set decoration and so forth, and you can get into not just other types of skill sets, but other types of interests, which I think is really important, because what we discussed, I think, prior was how important it is. We don't really have anything that I know of anyway that is specifically for middle school kids. And as somebody who taught middle school for 6 years, it was an interesting period of time. It's such a special and pretty well-defined age group that needs, I think, kind of pretty specific attention. And I'm glad to see this program.
I mean, the whole goal too is also to have all roads lead to specifically to our group, like to Heights Middle School Shorts, because we want our kids, for example, we're producing a program called Trailers, HMSS Trailers, which means fifth grade students in every single elementary can come on board and create a trailer. And then those trailers will be screened at our Heights Middle School Shorts screening that you go to, before the actual films. And so, and all of this is then sent to a film festival that will be seen all over. And I just think it's important to give our kids some resources to be able to say, hey, I can tell a story and I can write and I can produce and I can film, either behind the scenes. Sometimes the kids act in each other's, films, which is great. Mm-hmm. But it's just a pathway to what Cleveland Heights School District especially offers. Because eventually, for 9th and 10th grade, we want the kids, specifically at the high school, to create documentaries for our BIPOC community that have been inducted into the Heights Hall of Fame, where they can talk about their experiences and to have it documented, I think, and to reflect back on their experience as a high school student in the Heights and what they're doing now is really important to us. And to have the kids to be able to film that would be pretty amazing.
Absolutely. And you just brought to mind, with what you just said, I'm remembering when I was in high school, Heights High, there was a guy that made movies, and then he would have world premieres at his house, and it was a big deal. Mm. And if you look at the 1973 Cauldron, which you probably won't, it's filled with pictures of those movie premieres, and that person happens to live, just moved back to Cleveland Heights last year. I can't volunteer him, but, you know, because that's not...
We're always looking for drop-ins.
But this is a rah-rah Heights guy who is in the Heights High Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. And is a filmmaker. I mean, was a filmmaker, yeah. And is still very interested in that. So,
and we know I know someone personally that I grew up with through my sister, and she actually is an actress on The Resident, and she's a Heights alum. She was inducted into the Hall of Fame, and she lives out in LA. So, someone like that, for example, would be great to interview, whether it's virtual, whether it's maybe we take a trip out to LA. It's just those kind of things I think are important to full circle.
Okay.
I think that we realized that not all kids want to be directors.
Right. Or actors.
And a lot of them don't understand. And it turns out, too, that, you know, a film set's full of people that aren't directors.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
So, in fact, last year we rejiggered it so it's not. So they're key. A camera person, a sound person, someone who, you know, the director, someone who writes, a screenwriter, that kind of thing. And it really, hopefully, will open doors for people who aren't aggressive and push themselves out front.
Right.
Okay. And then just to be, I just want to clarify. So on the salaries, as I understand it, that this is just to get you up and going because you're a new not-for-profit.
Right.
And then after that, there'll be other funding.
Sure. And we are seeking out. Yes, that is correct.
For sure.
And we, just for the record, we are not a new program. We've been around for 8 years.
Right. Just a new not-for-profit.
But just a new for nonprofit. Yes.
Right. Yeah. And then, I mean, obviously, we need to replace anything we put in place. High on our list.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Mm-hmm. Yes, Counselor.
You and I talked a couple of years ago, and you talked about, this isn't really a question about funds, but what this program accomplishes for the students, mm-hmm. that the opportunity is given to them to find their creativity, to find what they're really interested in doing. And then I think you told me there were some other groups of people nationally that are interested in what you're doing. Can you name just a couple of those, please?
Yeah, so we actually are working with, we did work this past season, formed a relationship with Cleveland Film Commission. They came out to be a moderator for the students at the Greater Cleveland Urban Film Festival, which we've partnered with for the last 2 years to enter the films, and now we're moving on to our third year for next year. We just started a relationship with the Tri-C Film Academy as well. So we've built these three big organizations that really support programming students film within Cleveland, and we want to keep it local, of course, but we also want to expand. And then going further, we have a connection in LA who is a filmmaker, is an alum from Heights, who always wants to give back specifically to our group in particular, and he will be the filmmaker next year as the filmmaker and editor, but he is connecting us with someone out in LA as well. So we're working on figuring out all that, and hopefully, and they do want us to come out there to look at them. So it's just an opportunity.
Okay. Thank you. Thank
you. Perfect.
Yes.
Do we have any members still?
No, I don't. No one else?
No, not currently.
So they've said. Okay. 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 Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Next, we have Benjamin Rose Institute. And if you weren't here when I gave the kind of where what we're going to do here is that you have 15 minutes, which is up there. We're going to basically, we have your answers. People are going to ask any additional questions. You can give any update if you have any.
Sure. Great.
Okay.
Well, thank you again for having me. I'm Janice Brennan. I'm the CFO with Benjamin Rose. So all the finance side of things comes to me. Thank you for your diligence in considering all of the programs you just heard from the youth. Now we're going to talk about the seniors and housing. But our project is a one-time capital. It started 2019, I think, was our first try at getting some HUD 202 dollars. We were successful in the 2021 round of HUD 202. The project started as 20 new units. With the amount of funding that came in for HUD 202, we immediately knew we needed to find some other sources. So we already had 60 units in the building. Some of them are over 20 years old. The others were 2012, so rounding out near 10 years. So we looked to LIHTC, and we have LIHTC funding for a significant piece of the project. So we went from 20 units to 80, rehabbing 60 and 20 new. We have over $18.5 million budget for the project right now. We have started construction. So all of the teardown on the first floor where all the 20 new units will be, the abatement and everything needed to happen with that floor. And then the second and third are the newer of the existing units. So we have 36 units there. And the second floor is actually almost completely renovated as of today. We are going to move to the third floor next, and then the fourth and fifth floors, which have 24 of the existing units and are nearer to 20 years old, have a lot more extensive work to be done in those units. But we're on track with our project, which is very exciting for me. We continue to look to a date of completion in August of 2024, having all 80 units fully occupied and certified under the HUD 202 and the low-income housing tax credits by the end of 2024 is our goal. We're going to start moving some individuals into the completed units as we finish each of the floors, keeping about six unfinished so we can move residents within the building and not have to relocate them elsewhere and bring them back. So we do have some open units throughout the project. But again, you had your questions. As far as funding goes, like I said, we started with the HUD and the LIHTC. We've layered in some home funds. We just recently received another $1 million award from the county for ERA 2. We did have a small allotment of CDBG from the city, which helps with the front entrance, which we will be restoring the front entrance for the first time in years, since the project, really. The building also has Federal Home Loan Bank funds from Boston, and we have an application in to increase that allotment as well, which we hope to know by the end of this year. But we really continue to try to find resources and funds wherever we can. If you recall from the last time I was here, we've had pressure from not only the investment market, again, as we went through, everyone knows, with COVID, some of the losses in the market. And again, this year in the third quarter, we're seeing some hits. So we're trying to raise as much money as we can so we can preserve the long-term legacy of Benjamin Rose and this project being capital and within the city, keeping this building that we built in 1960 in use for our mission and keeping, again, the seniors housed and in the community is really our goal. So we've had the inflationary pressures and again, just continue to try to finance and fund wherever we can so that we can continue the legacy.
Yes, Councilor.
Thank you. So I have questions on your answers for number three and number seven. I'll start with number three, which is, can you provide a detailed breakdown of how the funds will be used, including administrative and programmatic expenses? And your answer was a little bit of a non sequitur for me. I mean, the fact that it's a one-time capital project and there's, you know, no ongoing operational expenses still doesn't preclude you from, I don't think, from answering the question, unless you're saying that this is, it's for, you know, the building, you know, and that's the $300,000. I mean, are you literally saying that? Yes. Is the only expense?
It is all going into capital. So the $18.5 million price tag is just the capital portion of this project. The ongoing operations of the building and the 202 are funded primarily through 202. So we do have the small rental payments from residents and then the 202, which again helps us to sustain the program. We have 40-year commitment to staying at 202 and the stipends and payments through that really fund the ongoing operations.
So there was no specific part of the capital budget that you were going to use the $300,000. It's just it's just part of the entire experience. Okay.
Right.
I understand that. And then on question number 7, which was how do you plan to ensure transparency and accountability in managing all the allocated funds? Can you explain what it is you're working with?
Sure.
Cleveland Housing Network and HUD and, I'm sorry, City.
Yeah, so we have weekly meetings with the entire construction crew, where we're at, overages under whatever it may be. I unfortunately do not sit in on those meetings. Our COO does attend those meetings. But I know the fire marshal has been involved and engaged throughout the project as far as what we need to do to bring the building up to code since it was built in the 60s. And then CHN, acting as our project manager, is helping with all the paperwork that we do have. So we have monthly reporting for the HUD 202 and the LIHTC. And so those reports are available for anyone that may need. Those are the A1A architects and then other updates. And then we have a monthly, or it's been about monthly, where we have to have, obviously, certificate of occupancy before we move anybody back into the existing units. So going through that whole process, and I understand this answer was not very detailed.
I didn't understand what it meant. It wasn't the detail. I didn't even know. I couldn't even get in the door on that.
Sorry.
That's all right.
But we do have those monthly meetings. And again, with all the federal dollars, we've been dealing with some significant reporting. The residents, because this is our first time with the low-income housing tax credits, the residents all have to be recertified before the end of the year and certified for the HUD 202 and LIHTC qualifications. But it's really the transparency in the level of reporting that is required with all of the federal dollars and that we are completing on a monthly basis and weekly in some cases.
So HUD helps you with the reporting. Cleveland Housing Network is not part of the reporting part.
Cleveland Housing Network is acting as the project manager and helping with the reporting and
putting
everything together with the architect and again, our chief operating officer that attends the meetings. They're the ones compiling everything and sending it to us for review and signing off before sending to HUD or LIHTC.
That's why you put it in that order. Okay. All right. Well, I understand it better now. Thank you.
I have a couple questions. Currently, you have 16 units and 5 residents were originally from Cleveland Heights, so about 8%. Mm-hmm. And on your new 20, five people are in waiting list are from Cleveland Heights, so that's 25%. Is that right?
Yeah, we keep a waiting list, or unfortunately have had a waiting list between 30 and 40. So of the individuals on the waiting list, there are about 5 from the city of Cleveland Heights. So we are definitely attracting residents from outside of the community into Cleveland Heights. We don't necessarily just market it to the city, but we do have residents that have chosen to live in Margaret Wagner House that are from the city as well.
Okay, and of your funding sources, how much do you have already committed of the 18.5?
Of the 18.5 in funding, and I don't have the dollar amount, so we, as Benjamin Rose, part of that is the valuation of the property as well. So you take about 2.2 off for the valuation of the property. We have just shy of $3 million committed. $3 million not committed, I guess. So of the 18.5, we have about $3 million not committed that, again, will come out of our investment dollars. The board had approved that from the beginning, if needed.
Okay.
Madam President?
Yes.
Could you just clarify, when you said there are 5 people from Cleveland Heights on the waiting list, out of how many? On the waiting list?
It averages between 30 and 40 people on the waiting list. It's grown a little bit because we've kept some units open for, again, keeping individuals within the building through construction.
Thank you.
Yes.
What criteria are used to determine who gets in from their waiting list?
We go through it on first come, first serve. So whoever's on the list in that order is who we would go through. We do find sometimes people drop off by themselves before we can get to them, unfortunately, hoping with the additional 20 units that we will be able to reduce that waiting list to single digit numbers and maintain it at a lower, but it's really first come, first serve, and then they have to qualify for the HUD 202 and LIHTC, so the low income percentiles.
And I'm assuming you have some employees at this facility?
We do.
Do you know about how many?
So for the apartment specifically?
Or just in general, how many employees are there at the facility? They don't have to be connected. I'm just trying to find out what contribution you guys are making to the city. So obviously, if you have employees, they're paying a payroll tax.
We have six specific to the apartments, but then all of our home-delivered meals, jumpers, and drivers do work out of that location as well. That's where they pick up the food and deliver it. So we have about 18 in that role as the jumper and driver, and probably three or four administrative that primarily work out of this location and are on the city tax. So.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you very much.
Again, thank you for your time.
Okay, our next, we have Reaching Heights. Hi.
Hi. Good morning.
Good morning.
So we're here today to have your answers, and it's for people to ask you any additional questions or follow up on these answers, and then if you have any updates that you wanted to give us.
So I don't have any specific updates, just, you know, some time has passed and we've had community care team meetings and we have our Many Village tutoring program up and running, and so we continuously receive more information about what's needed and what's happening. And it's interesting, you know, we're, what would you say, three years since COVID started, and the effects are long lasting. So, you know, and think about, like, I just was talking to a friend of mine whose daughter spent her whole college years during COVID, and that has really changed her experiences in terms of growing up, you know, as an independent adult and socializing and meeting people. But I think about what our teachers are requesting now is support for not just third graders, but the fourth and fifth graders. And we're really concerned too, even about the first and second graders who didn't have full preschool experiences. So as we're always concerned about students who haven't had preschool experiences. So the request for support is, you know, K-12, actually P-12. So, and we have expanded this year to the high school, where there's extensive need now for the tutors who come into the AVID program. So we're helping there. So these, you know, updates about what's needed and how much is needed. We just had a community care team meeting at Noble where they have three classes of each grade, and they have three volunteers. So a fully staffed village for kindergarten with three classrooms would be 12 tutors, and they have three. So that's what we're looking at, is trying to boost the numbers, connect the community more fully, help people understand exactly what's going on in our schools and where our community can help fill those gaps.
And you're partially funded by the school district?
Not at all. No, we're a support organization to the school district, so we don't want to ask for funding. But when we do events, they do offer space in kind. Or like for our summer music camp, we use, when students need to borrow instruments from the school district, that's available. But no, our mission is to mobilize community resources to support our school district.
Yes, Counselor.
Good morning, Krista.
Good morning.
I'm looking at the very last paragraph on your answer to all of our questions, and it kind of startled me a bit, and I reread it this morning. We were asking, what will you do for funding support, or if there were ESSER funds available, which we have been advised there are no more ESSER funds available anyway. You said, are you talking about your staff or are you talking about the CHUH staff when you say
The funds end in September 2024. The schools will lose many adults, approximately 68, offering supports to students in each of the 11 buildings. Can you explain that just a little bit for me to clarify?
So those are the professionals or, you know, success tutors that have been hired through the ESSER III funds for the school district by the school district. So when those funds end, this is the basis of this proposal, is there will be a cliff. There will be a sudden withdrawal of all of that support. And can we as a community come together to minimize that cliff?
Thank you.
Okay. Additional questions?
No, I just make a comment that you have from where I'm sitting, a reasonable and realistic request of us. So I appreciate that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay.
Well,
me? Okay. Should we take a 5-minute break?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, so we're going to adjourn for 5 minutes, or not adjourn, but pause for 5 minutes. Okay, I'm calling this meeting back to order. Committee of the Whole. And the next group we're going to hear from is Artful. And we didn't receive your answers to the question.
I sent them on Friday. Well.
Okay. Okay, so maybe you can just, we have 15 minutes.
Right.
For each not-for-profit, so maybe you can briefly.
Okay, well, I can briefly go over what I said.
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Okay, so your first question was, what happens to the organization program when the ARPA funds are used up, and what are your future plans for funding that may replace the funds? So my answer was, American Rescue Funds would allow us to increase our reach in the community and in the nonprofit world, ostensibly closing the gap created by the pandemic. The pandemic delayed our plans in every possible way, and as an organization, we received no relief locally or federally. These funds would allow Artful to move our current recovery strategic plan ahead by 2 years, giving us a much-needed boost. At the end of those 2 years, we would be eligible for larger grants and operational support from Cuyahoga Arts and Culture and Ohio Arts Council. So those would basically replace the funds that we'd be getting, because we'd be able to get the larger funds. And any new studios that we build with these funds would also bring additional revenue as soon as they were ready.
Okay.
Can you provide a detailed breakdown of how these funds will be used, including administrative and program expenses? So I know that you would like as much detail as possible, because, you know, your decision is likely going to be under the microscope, but for us, as a nonprofit, this would be the largest amount of money that we would ever ask for, and right now it's hypothetical, so it's really hard for us to spend a lot of time figuring out what we're going to spend for money that we don't know we're going to get, because I'm the staff. So I broke it down pretty basically, but basically we would use the majority of it to pay Robin Van Leer to be our community director, and that would give her the freedom to promote and do more works in Artful's name out in the public and gathering the public together, which is what we've been lacking, I think, mostly. So anything that Robin does, she would be doing it as our artistic director in Cleveland Heights. Let's see what else.
President, could you put a number on that?
If we had 2 years, for Robin, I would probably say it's like $40,000 for 2 years.
$20,000 a year?
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
And then we also, our current marketing director is also our chairman of our board, who's, you know, giving up that responsibility. So we would use the other, another 10 to, you know, put towards a new, you know, website and all that development, because she's leaving and she's, you know, we have to readjust for that. $6,000 we would lease for more space to create more studios. So that would just, that would basically pay for like a month or two of rent while we did the build out and the materials for the build out. And then as soon as they were built out, we would be able to rent and get, recoup the money from them. We need new sinks and electrical in certain studios, so we would use, it's hard to tell how much that would be, but I said $4,000. We also need to pay for a professional audit, which is quite expensive in order to get those larger grants. So you have to, they, you know, foundations and want to see that you, you know, you've been, your books have been looked over professionally by, you know, with a fine-tooth comb to make sure that you're, you know, but that costs somewhere between $10,000 and $30,000, depending on how big your organization is. So I put $10,000 down there for that. I'd also, we'd also really like to pay the artists that do our curator events, because they put weeks and weeks of work into it. So I'd like to put aside $3,000 to pay those artists for the events. And I think that's about it for the what the breakdown is. The key outline, the outline key milestones and deliverables would be, we think that with the dedication of a community director and a new, you know, person doing our social media, that we will, you know, presence will just get larger and larger, which makes it us more, you know, more visible and more eligible for all the, you know, the other grants that we're going to be going for in the future. Same metrics. The more we commit to the community, the more we engage the community. Those are our metrics, because that's who we were trying to reach. You know, the bigger our events get, the more people come through. Every event we have, more and more people come. So that's pretty much it. Anything, or can you provide a plan for regular reporting? We would do whatever you'd like us to do. We could, whatever is needed. Since we haven't had a grant of that size yet, where, you know, we just tell us what you need and we'll do it. how do you plan to ensure transparency and accountability? Just meticulous record keeping and of all expenditures. Diversity, equity, inclusion. All of our decisions are brought before the Artful Board, which is a diverse group in itself. And we have everything that we do benefits a diverse group of people, because our artists are a very diverse group of people, and they're the main, you know, the main people that get the benefit of everything we do. But if you've ever come to an event, you'll see that it's amazing. There's just people from everywhere, all over. It brings people together from all different walks of life, and it's wonderful. So that's our main objective, is to bring, you know, to buy diverse groups. And what contingency plans? We would adapt, because that's what we do. You know, right now this money would be amazing to receive, but we're not banking on it in any sense of the world. So we'd just go back to our regular plan. You know, this money would be a gift. You know, it'd be like the greatest thing that could happen to us at this point. But we're not, you know, we're still on our strategic plan as follows, and if we don't get it, we'll just continue on, you know. So okay, that's all.
Any additional questions?
And you are a 501c?
Yes.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay, thank you.
By the way, I did find your email in my spam folder. I sent it to everyone. I apologize. It wasn't showing up in my thread because of that.
Okay.
Yes. Addie, could you email that to us?
Yeah, I just hired it.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. That'd
be great.
Before she goes, does she have a few minutes? Let me take a quick look.
Yeah.
Okay.
I love saving things.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to just chime in that our goal is part of the whole transformation we call with Coventry. And it's a wonderful grassroots organization. And along with Coventry Peace Park and the library, that end of the street is getting stronger and stronger. We hope that positivity will continue through our district.
Addition to Coventry. How many years now?
Seven
years. So, and their outreach to the community is what it's about.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Steve. It's Friday. So, Coventry Peace Talks.
Doesn't come up, does it? Are we? Let me see if I have it here. I don't have it yet. Okay, I got it.
Couple questions.
Here it is. Okay. Yeah, we're going to, can you come up back up? Because the mic is up here. Go ahead.
And I apologize, and Addie may also be able to answer this question. We, in your previous request to us, did it include your current budget and expenditures?
No.
Did we ever ask you about that?
No, I don't.
Okay, so what is the current budget that you guys have now?
Our current budget is about $125,000 a year. About $75,000 of that goes to our rent, so.
And the rent is, you're at the Coventry school?
Directly to the library.
Okay. And the community director position, would this be a new position or is?
It's a new position. It is in our strategic plan for 3 years from now.
Okay.
If we could get it started earlier with this money, that would be great because then we'd be even more likely to get the fund, you know, the operational support from Cuyahoga Arts and Culture or Ohio Arts Council if it was already there because we've proven it. We'd have metrics to say that it's working, that it's beneficial, and then it's much easier for us to get the money at that point.
Is the strategic plan something that you already have in writing?
I mean, it's right. Honestly, we have it half written because we're kind of waiting to decide what you guys do.
Okay.
I mean, we know what the plan is. We have our goals that we want to meet, but it's not in writing. I mean, we're a very small organization in comparison, but the majority of, the majority of foundations and grants that are available to organizations our size are very, very limited. But as soon as you add another position and that much more money to your budget, you all of a sudden opens this huge door to this whole other group of, that you're more serious and you get more money, So right now we're just people to go, we don't care about them, but that the goal is to get bigger and bigger so we can get that support.
Okay. Other questions? No?
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Coventry Village.
Here. They both said they would be here.
thinking from which, maybe they don't know what room they're in.
It could be. Maybe they're going to the wrong room. Yeah, he's texting.
What would be your
ah, good.
Top three priorities.
They found them.
You had to pick, there were five.
We are on it. We are on air. Yes, we're right. We're ready for Coventry. Okay. Yeah, can you come up to the microphone? We have your questions.
Okay.
And so, what's going to happen is we'll have 15 minutes.
Okay.
And at that point, you. We have your questions. So we have all your answers, so you don't have to worry about those. We'll give an opportunity for council members to ask any additional questions that they might have or follow-up questions. And then if you have something else you wanted to say that was an update, you could. So do you guys, anyone have questions?
So can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
You guys have this proposal, the PowerPoint that we originally made one the first time we were all here, and then we updated it, and it was emailed, I believe, to everybody, but it was a while ago. So I wasn't sure that Cole had sent it to everybody or just went to Addie, or I'm not sure, but I made one copy of it because it sort of outlines exactly what we were asking for in the updated version. I don't know if you've seen this. It's very pretty.
Yeah, I believe I sent that to you guys via email. I did not print it out for today, though.
Yeah.
Okay, I could share it up there if that was a thing, but if it's not necessary, then.
Okay, so. Okay. Any questions?
I'm sorry, Madam President.
Yes.
Kathy, I know one of the questions was, I think there were five priorities and then, you know, which ones would be the top three and then those were listed. Who answered that question, do you know?
Well, I think we met as a group.
It was collective.
Okay. It was a collective thing. So we kind of analyzed the points, the talking points, and while we recognize that safety is a huge concern of ours on the street, and I think all the districts, we thought that should really be handled by the city. Didn't really think it was the job of the CID to triage that particular point. And we thought the public art component, which we also think is very important, could probably be better addressed by either Artful or Heights Arts collaboratively with Coventry, because that's really their expertise, and we didn't want to sort of double dip, and we probably would have gone to them for guidance and collaboration anyway. So the thought being that those two things could be handled outside of our realm of expertise, and better.
And that makes sense. I was just wondering if you or anybody connected with the Coventry proposal had contacted the administration about the security.
We have not, but we bring it up a lot. I mean, we have not specifically addressed it. I've had conversations with the chief many times about it. We've talked about the need for beat cops in the city, and especially in the business districts, all of them, to be honest. And I know from speaking with, you know, multiple business owners, we all think this is a priority. The Lee Road business owners, the Coventry, most importantly. I think Cedar Fairmont had a guy for a while. He was doing it, and I'm not sure if he's still there. And that was the only district, to my knowledge, that really even had anybody designated. And it was my understanding after talking with him that he specifically requested to be at Cedar Fairmont, but I'm not sure if that's true or not. Regardless, I think that is a number one priority for our district. But it's really not for us. I mean, we're not the police department. So I thought that should be addressed outside of this ask, hopefully. but we do feel it's very important.
We are budgeted
for
beat cops currently.
Oh, good.
The problem has been
finding them, right?
Airing.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's been that. But I agree. And when
we were paying it out of our own pocket, which was before any of this came about, when we recognized the need for it, we hired beat cops. You know, I think it was Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, and it was a 4 or 5 hour shift. So it can be done. I mean, I know it's difficult, and I know the chief constantly has problems finding people, but I think it can be done. It just needs to be prioritized. When we were paying top dollar, they showed up, put it that way.
Of course, we have union contracts.
Yeah. So, no, we were paying overtime. I mean, I can't remember what it was. I think it was, I'd have to look it up again, but it was, we for a while, it was a budget item for the CID, you know, security, so.
Okay. Yes.
To go back to your willingness to coordinate with Heights Arts and Artful, on the original presentation, you have a public art request for $44,500. Is that something you want to keep in your ask, or do you want us to?
Well, if you're going to give us all the money, we'll take everything. But
that's not fair.
But if it was a pick and choose, I would think that it'd be better for that portion of the money to go to the arts organizations who really, that's their specialty. And then with the understanding that Coventry would be a line item, prioritized, like if they get $50, we want 20 of it, you know, or whatever that
is. Like a specific dollar value, what we're asking essentially is what we've determined what would be appropriate level of service for our district. So that should be allocated to the appropriate organization earmarked specifically.
Yeah. All right, thank you.
Thank you. I had a couple questions. When I'm looking at a pop-up,
okay.
One thing is property owners. Like, you know, some of the property owners are not taking care of the property.
So I can share with you that as somebody who's done pop-ups in Coventry, I'm acutely aware of the state of a number of the pop-ups. Like the properties have been, there are some very inexpensive things that you can do to kind of put some lipstick on it for the short-term project. So we're not necessarily looking to do major renovations or anything long-term. The funding would essentially go more for the infrastructure and the planning.
And we also wanted to stress on that we are not trying to reward landlords who are not taking care of their properties. What we want is neighbors on the street. And we, you know, are coming from a place of, like, this affects us more than anybody in the room because we need, you know, more businesses on the street to thrive. And it wouldn't be necessarily a reward to the landlords. I think it would have to be specifically, they would also have to participate. They couldn't, you know, not necessarily a match, but it would be an addition to whatever that they could offer. So let's say there was a mini grant program and it facilitated, like, you know, fixing up the property so that they could move in. We would want to see a contribution from the landlord, whether that be a match in kind of doing some other work or a rent reduction or something like that. I think it would have to be participating on both sides. So we're not necessarily rewarding people who are not doing their job.
Yeah. And, you know, again, just to kind of touch back on my experience doing pop-ups, you know, they definitely work. You attract people, you give them an opportunity to build a relationship with the district, and then they become tenants. Which we're really excited about. Just to touch on what Kathy's discussing too, in terms of, you know, not putting the dollars into the landlord's pocket. It's true not only for the pop-up program, but for the tenant improvement dollars as well.
And when they, after 3 months, because they're a pop-up for 3 months.
So, you know, 3 months is definitely an amount of time that we've done them before, but it can, you know, kind of vary. The goal is to transition them into a permanent tenant.
Okay, so the goal would be to have them transition into some facility on the street.
Yeah.
And it talked about rent discounts.
I think that's what we were specifically looking. If we, let's say their space A gets some improvements and it attracts a tenant, well, in turn, that tenant should see a rent reduction from the landlord. So we're not just giving the landlord, you know, we're not painting his space and putting in bathrooms and fixing all his electrical for him to just absorb all the benefits. Mm-hmm. He he or she should participate in the cost of that.
Shouldn't the landlord be fixing all that stuff?
Yes, but they're not, is the problem. And, you know, so the, you know, we can't, you know, sell a turd. We have to shine it up a little, basically. The, you know, these spaces need help. And if the landlords aren't doing it, we would like to see people in those spaces. So I don't think that they necessarily are going to benefit. They'll benefit long term with the tenant, but we would want a participation from them as well. We're not going to just hand it out.
Right.
And to that end, anytime there's a commercial piece, there are some responsibilities that fall on the landlord and some responsibilities that fall on the tenant. Essentially, what we're doing is we're creating a little bit of a quid pro quo. I say that goodly. Quid pro quo. Where, you know, we're encouraging landlords to be more competitive because we have these programs and abilities in place to secure tenants for them if they're willing to play. Come to the table and negotiate.
Yes.
And do you believe all these programs can be structured such that there can be a drawdown on funds as these programs progress? Because I don't want to get in a situation with any organizations where we're making an upfront contribution. And then the money is not all spent or spent as allocated. Am I being clear about what I'm trying to?
So what you're saying is more of we put these programs in place, we submit an invoice to you and you pay direct to vendors sort of
a program? Or that there would be a commitment, all right, this is the amount of money that's available, and then you know you would draw down on it based upon when you're filling out, when you get a pop up in a space or when someone meets your criteria to get a rent reduction, things of that nature.
Be structured in terms of lead time for drawdown. Is that something that can be instantaneous?
Yeah, I mean that would be it. That you know, then the I guess the details need to be worked out. But for all of these programs, I'm sort of envisioning that in some circumstances would be the process.
Instead of just saying, "Here's a big pot of money, go."
Go run with it,
yeah.
Right.
No, yeah, I think that there should be checks and balances in place, like any sort of budget for anything, yes.
Absolutely, I mean, I definitely would love to see a certain level of transparency and accountability. Like, are we breaking out everything into individual pots and accounts specifically for each organization? Like, I think that would definitely be a critical consideration as well.
This question is more for President Hart. On the placemaking and pedestrian improvements, they requested money for curb extensions and traffic calming. Should that not be a budget event or a budget line item from the city? And they would have to be closely worked together with the administration in order to do something.
They would have to work closely with the administration on it. In terms of budget item for the city, they create their own budget for streets and where the traffic right. calming is. So, and that's based on whatever their traffic studies are. So whether that's in the budget or not, I don't know that at this point because we haven't gotten the new budget.
Right.
But we would need to look at that to see if it was there.
Is there a way to ask before the 31st?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, just send an email.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, and we can definitely break out the allocation between placemaking and pedestrian improvements, because those would be two separate things. So if that's something that the city wants to field, then we can definitely break that out and allocate it. Yeah, perfect.
Okay, Councilor Kuda.
Thank you. Back to the pop-ups. Well, first of all, if landlords want to be more competitive, they can lower their rents. I mean, I don't know what's holding that up with 18 vacancies. You'd think that would... the market forces would drive that, but back to the pop-ups. So, how do you plan on, or do you plan on coordinating with the city's economic development department as far as what they already do and who they've already contacted, or who contacts them on a regular basis? I mean, I don't know the answer to that, but my question is how. You know, how would you do this in a way that would be collaborative so that you're not repeating perhaps other outreaches and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, we can definitely keep lines of communication open and make sure we're, you know, reaching out. But I can share, we have relationships with plenty of merchants. You know, I partner for my own, you know, personal business and other things with Jumpstart ECDI, Women's Business Center. So there's, you know, a pipeline of businesses that have support that are looking for places. That we can definitely tap.
We price becoming smaller meetings as well, like our smaller meetings as just this organization as well as our SID meetings. So he's acutely aware. And we've definitely asked many times to have a list. I wanted to look to see who has reached out in the past year and why haven't they been here and why haven't they chosen Coventry. We really wanted to analyze that. So we've definitely made the ask for that list and we could follow up to get that. So we maybe there are people out there that have already crossed our path, so we weren't aware of because we're not the landlords, but yeah.
I mean, I'm glad to hear, Ash, to all these resources, you know, I just, it's just a piece of,
right.
You know.
No, I mean, I'm all for it. If, yeah. If, yeah. If there's information to be shared, we'd love to hear it.
So a question for you, a little bit unrelated.
Okay.
So if we were to look at a legislation to try to encourage landlords to properly get their places re-rented, do you think a tax on vacancies over a certain length of time is a valid one, or do you have other suggestions?
I don't know that I necessarily have a suggestion, but I do have pushback for like blackout policies from landlords. Typically what ends up happening is that they will just rent to anybody. Does not necessarily mean that they've properly vetted a tenant. They've rented, the tenant goes out of business, but they've done their part. Or they, you know, that's how you get dollar stores and check cashing places. You know, not that those don't provide services, but for a district like Coventry Village, we're not necessarily then attracting the right type of clientele or merchant for that district. So I think that if we're talking about putting those types of policies in place, we really need to think about the potential, you know, cons to that as well.
I think also that maybe cracking down on the improvements. We're going to be doing improvements to these buildings. They should have already been done.
Yeah.
So maybe going, whether rather it being a tax because it's empty, maybe it should be, you need to fix this, this, and this because they're violations.
Yeah.
And I don't, you know, I've been on the street for 30 years now. You know, Tony used to come in. They were tough, the building department.
Yeah.
And you fixed things and you did it right. And it was, and I don't see that happening as much anymore.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, so perhaps that way would make more sense, you know,
okay.
than... Because it's forcing them to fix the problem, which will then make the space look better, will make it easier to rent. It's just, seems like a more proactive way to deal with it.
And to take it one step further, I think that's true not only for the commercial properties, but also the residential apartments and the rental properties. So I think that that's definitely a two-pronged approach.
Yeah, I don't know what the legality is of letting them in spaces that aren't rented. You know, it's like when you want to make a change, then they slap you with everything. I don't know what you could do to get in for places that have been empty for this long because you're not really trying to rent it.
Yeah.
To have legislation specifically around vacant properties and inspections.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay, thanks very much.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have Family Connections.
Good afternoon. How's everybody?
Hi. So what we'll be doing is it'll be 15 minutes, and we have your answers to your questions, and counselors may want to ask additional follow-up questions. Which they'll do. And then if you have something else you wanted to tell us that was an update, if you had any updates to your proposal.
Okay.
Does anyone have any questions? Yes.
Good morning.
I'd just like to confirm that the plan to extend services from 4 weeks to 8 weeks for our families is going to be, that's what this funding is going to help with, correct?
Yes. What happened is that we did a pilot over at Oxford Elementary, and so it was in between spring break and a lot of other projects that were going on in the district, and so we did a four-week project, but we met with we met with the staff from Hope Behavior Health, who was a therapist that we hired. We met with school staff. We got input from families, and they decided that we needed to spend additional time. So that's why we increased it to 8 weeks. And not only, but we're also expanding it to three additional schools. I also have a letter of support from the superintendent.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Thank you.
The impact. And I like to say that I was over at Oxford and I saw the social worker that we work with who mentioned that we had a little boy in kindergarten and we had a first grader who really lacked basic skills, self-regulation skills, were running out of the building, who were hitting teachers. So I happened to see the counselor, and she told me that those kids had really made a turnaround this year. And what I would like to say is that we had, in one of the situations, we had a little boy whose parents were co-parenting. And so you have one parent who was the Disneyland dad who had everything, and you had the mom who was a strict and firm person. So we brought them into the room, and we had a hard conversation about being consistent. And so we think that's part of why that child was able to turn around. So.
Any other questions?
I don't have any.
Okay, thank you.
Wow, okay. Thank you.
Okay. And last, but certainly not least, is Heights Arts.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi.
I have a few comments, unless there are questions immediately.
Yeah. We know that Eddie hasn't restarted the timer.
Oh.
So don't worry.
Okay. You can just shut me up whenever you want.
Yeah, three more minutes than that.
Okay. Well, I just had a couple of comments based on what I've heard previously in some of these presentations, and one of the things that I wanted to comment on when something that Steve said about Coventry, and in my research for presenting this proposal to everybody, because it was kind of exciting for me to go back to our roots and how we actually implemented our public art projects. And I was talking to an employee at Land Studio, and he said that our collaboration with the Coventry Benches and Fences actually set a national standard that other people looked at in terms of collaboration. And Artful has been talking about collaboration, as has the Coventry District. And I think, you know, that's what we're trying to get back to with these kinds of proposals. And to Ash's point about pop-ups, I just wanted to mention that Heights Arts began as a pop-up in the Cedarly District, and we're still there 23 years later. So I think that's an important statement on what they're asking for. So I can, if you have questions, I can answer them, or I can just highlight some of the things that I put in my answers.
Any questions? Yes.
I'd just like to confirm that you're looking at the whole city for future projects.
Yes. Yeah. And that was when we learned of this opportunity, you know, really we haven't had a chance to do these kinds of projects for a while, mostly because whenever we're approached, we say, great, we'd love to do it. What's your budget? And then the people that want to have the public art say, oh, but you don't have the money for that? You can't put it together. So, you know, we've got quite a few high-profile projects already in the Cedar Lea District with the mural and the Cedar Fairmount District and with Coventry Benches and Fences. And we really have a mission to bring public art to the entire city. And so one of the questions was, how will we identify those areas? Well, I think they've kind of already been identified, but I did do a little bit of research on it. The city has already identified the three neighborhoods that deserve some love, and we would love to give them some love as well. So I think, you know, this could just be a discussion. And I did, after learning about Coventry's decision, add in that Coventry had mentioned that they would also consider working with either Artful or Heights Arts on these projects, because again, that is what we do. So we actually welcome that, and that's our name is Heights Arts Collaborative. That's how we started, and that's how we'd like to continue. So I did identify the three neighborhoods that have already been identified. There are many ways to identify areas of need, and I feel that the city is probably the best at determining that, because the city knows where those areas are.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I did also want to just point out something that occurred to me when I was creating these answers that were not in our original proposal. And it was through talking with a public art expert. And it occurred to me that we have an opportunity as well, if were we to receive funding, to collaborate through our internship with the high school. Because one of the things that was mentioned is that it's very hard for an artist to break into public art because of all of the things involved and all of the knowledge that you have to have. It's almost like trying to get credit. You have to have credit to get credit. And we already have a very successful and statewide recognized program in our partnership through the Cleveland Heights High School. And this could be an opportunity for us to provide those high school students, if they are working with whoever the chosen artists are, to gain some experience and spark a little bit of interest in them pursuing public art in the future, or at least, you know, understanding what's involved. So I did add that in because it could be a really nice opportunity for a program that we already have to expand, that we've already received recognition and funding for, and could be a really interesting deep learning experience for them. So that's as part of the budget section, which we did not originally propose. And then I did add something that was not asked by this by council, but I wanted to make sure that it was clear. You know, when you're putting together a budget, every nonprofit knows that things happen, as every one of us has mentioned, that we're all prepared for anything because that's how we've had to work. But, you know, if we were to receive, let's say, the ask of $250,000, perhaps there's $10,000 left over, or perhaps one of our projects might go $10,000 over the budget. Well, we would work to find other funding to complete a project if it's on either side of that funding, so that we'll do our best to make sure that it's all used up one way or the other, either by an extra new project or by an extra new project is how it would work.
Yes, Councillor.
For this ask, how many projects do you think that you would be capable of doing over the next 3 years?
It really, as I mentioned in my proposal, is very hard to say that because it depends on the location, what would be there, the types of proposals that we receive from artists. You know, if it was all murals, there would obviously be more projects. If some of them were more involved, then that would be take up more expenses, obviously, in fabrication and that kind of a thing. So, you know, I think we could all agree on a minimum number of projects, and that would be fine with me. And then, you know, we could go from there. But it's really difficult to say. We would like to see several public art projects. If we're talking about three neighborhoods, at least three, and maybe working with Coventry. So, you know, ballpark figures, maybe $50,000 per project has been thrown out there, but you just really don't know until you get into it and you know the site conditions and that kind of a thing.
Yes, Councillor Kuda.
How would you go about recruiting artists, like if it's a mural project that maybe, well, first of all, is this for just Cleveland Heights artists to hire just people who live in Cleveland Heights?
No, not necessarily, but I mean, we serve artists in the greater Cleveland area. But there are some Cleveland Heights artists that, you know, as we think about it, if they apply, they would absolutely be qualified. So it's both things. I mean, if our main priority is that it's an equitable process and that the works live in Cleveland Heights and are in Cleveland Heights to beautify our city and our neighborhood. If there were restrictions on Cleveland Heights artists, we could certainly do that. But we don't know necessarily how many projects and how many of them would have public art experience.
Oh, and I could understand why, you know, for a particular project, there might be somebody who's perfect for the project that just happens to, you know, not live here.
Yeah.
Thematically, how would you evaluate the appropriateness of a public art project thematically in Cleveland Heights? Like, what would be that? What would that look like?
When you say thematically, like looking for the location or the content?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I really think that's kind of up to the artist. And so normally what happens is there's a request for qualifications and the artists would give their qualifications. And what we're proposing is that we go through a process with public engagement of where these works might live. Where they would be. And so then from there, I think the artist would propose a theme, and that's when the work would be chosen by members of the community, members of our community team. And so I don't think we would necessarily limit anybody on the theme or the subject matter.
Okay, thank you.
And I think just to clarify, part of the money of this proposal will go towards public engagement, meeting with people in the neighborhoods, making sure, you know, I'm told, but I already know that you have to have buy-in from the community. And, you know, you may be proposing an artwork and someone from the community says, yeah, that's not going to work in our neighborhood. So we want to make sure that that whatever we put in those neighborhoods has been looked at by the people who actually live there.
Okay, other questions?
I have one.
Yeah.
Not quite related, but kind of related. You know those metal boxes that are all around the city?
I do.
That are ugly?
Mm-hmm.
And all these other cities have them painted pretty?
Yeah, they're actually wrapped. And yeah. Shaker just went through this process. Yeah, a friend of mine actually did one of them. And we were approached by the Cedar Lee Cid about doing them, but then nothing ever came of it. I don't know, again, if there was no money. But that is that's an easy one to, I don't mean easy as in it's easy, but that could be all over the city where, I mean, it's a lovely idea and it's an idea that would absolutely work with this project.
It's wrapped.
Yeah, well, it's designed by an artist, but then the material, it's not necessarily paint, because it has to...
like saran wrap around it?
Well, you know how they do, I don't know what the material is, maybe somebody else here does, but...
Vinyl,
I guess,
okay.
Yeah, it might also be another kind of material. I talk a lot with the Document Output Center at CIA, and they have different kinds of materials, and we're talking about using a certain kind of material. Like sometimes there's an aluminum material that you can stick on, but the artist designs it, it's printed, and then it goes on the box.
Oh, okay. Kind of like a Band-Aid.
It's a lovely idea, yeah.
Good shelf
life, too. Yeah. Well, and that's what I mean, because if it's painted on, I mean, you can, as I mentioned, many of the projects all of the projects that we did that weren't temporary are still standing and in excellent condition. So... you have to look at the materials and you have to make sure that you're using the right materials so that a year from now, I mean, it's not gone. Right. And to that end, actually, I just want to talk about the last part of my proposal, and that is that if we were to engage in these projects, we would ask that the city consider to have a main contact that we could communicate with. This is what happened before, which is what made our projects successful. You know, there may be code or other things that that need to be addressed, and we would ask for that, and we would ask for consideration of a fund or budget line item that would pay for future repair and maintenance on these public art installations.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so that is all of our guests today.
So we will plan on having our next meeting on October 31st, 9:30. Right, 9:30, yeah. And we'll be discussing allocations. And that doesn't mean, you know, that's the end of it, because, you know, we might add to things if we feel they need to be added to. But I appreciate everyone's time, and this meeting is now adjourned.